السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. والبريز إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. Choice based on faith and peace. أنا بلاد الباسطة نبينا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. On his family, on his good companions, all of those who follow him to the day of rising. الحمد لله. شكر الله سبحانه وتعالى once again. We have our beloved Sidi Sani Mani who was here last week, alhamdulillah, to join us. And he got a little bit inside of us as last week's presentation. And as we understand that Sidi Sani Mani had the series on the predestination and the series of Tahir and the cause and effect and free will and the career of Allah. And he promised that he wanted to touch on that again, but also because he always understood from last presentation the need to also look into the spiritual aspects of substance abuse and drug abuse. And Dr. Yusuf Balkan will be joining us. You see, he was here for about 100 minutes. He will join us again, inshallah. Because last week, alhamdulillah, he gave us a little bit of the psychoanalysis of drug abuse and substance abuse, alhamdulillah. But tonight, inshallah, beloved Sidi Sani Mani will continue giving us insight also, as you can see on the of Tawheed, and thereby also his experience of being a lecturer at the rehabilitation center of drug abuse in Athna. He's got some insight into that also, inshallah. So he will share with us that also, inshallah. So welcome, Sidi Sani Mani. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani r-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad wa ashabi wa barik wa sallim. Oh ya Allah, make this night a night that's beneficial to us. Make it easy for us to understand and all of us benefit from this evening. Both in the first part and in the second part. In the second part where we will be touching on, inshallah, on the problems that the community is confronted with. Oh ya Allah, send down your solutions to us, because everything comes from you. Not only the difficulties, but all the solutions. Everything comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we are looking for solutions, then we must realize one thing. The moment we rely on anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah will point us in the direction till we start seeing that everything comes from Allah. Both the difficulties as well as the solutions. Allah created illnesses, but Allah also created cures. So if we get that right, then we are on the first step of success, inshallah. But we can't just say we believe in Allah. We must make effort to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are taught that one of the ways of getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to get to know the sifat by which Allah is known. Die 20 sifat wat almal geleer het toe hulle kinders was. En as jy vir die groot mense nou vra, drie kwart van hulle vergeet. Hulle sal weer gaan opkyk en opcheck. But then people will only be able to tell us die 20 sifats without being able to elaborate on it. And that has been given to us by our ancestors. Ons oumas en oupas en grootvaders en moeders het ons geleer van die. Now we must not neglect that. Your quality of your ibadah will be so much better, so much deeper, if you make effort to understand the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the thing that we are talking about here, about predestination, wat is uitgesit? Hoe verdui in met die choice wat Allah voor ons gegee het? En waar kom punishment en reward in? Is een van die arkaans van iman. We claim to have iman, but what effort are we making to understand these issues? So inshallah, I thought I should just quickly recap. That we spoke about three sifat that are linked. A sifat is an attribute by which Allah is known. The one is that Allah has knowledge, we said. The three sifat, if we get to understand these three sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will have a much better understanding of how predestination or the decree of Allah actually works. And waarvoor choice kan we? Als we praat van Allah heeft ons choice gegeven, maar Allah heeft ook uitgezet. Nou, hoe verstaan we ons daar? Ons moet al drie die sifat recht verstaan. At least a basic level of understanding. Ons kan nooit ooit alles verstaan van die sifat van Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Niemand kan niet. Because Allah is so perfect that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself can know his true perfection. No one, nothing in the entire creation. Only Allah knows himself truly. But we must have a basic level of understanding so that our belief system can remain true. Now the hadith that we quoted last time was that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that 50,000 years before Allah created anything, Allah instructed the pen to record what is going to happen. Instructed the pen, write down everything that's going to happen in the entire universe from the beginning of creation to the end of creation. Now that can be very confusing for us. But we went through that part last time. And the important thing to note and to make this hadith be understood correctly is to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the pen to record what is going to happen. Allah didn't decree our choices. Because Allah is all-knowing. We're talking about the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is all-knowing. So time has been created by Allah. So time, yesterday, tomorrow, now, whatever, has no impact on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows everything. Before we were even created, Allah knew everything about this entire creation. So when we talk about the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we must understand that time has absolutely no influence or impact on what Allah knows. Something doesn't have to happen first before Allah knows. Allah knows already. So Allah knew what was going to happen. And Allah instructed the pen to record. Allah knew what our choices were going to be. It's easy for Allah to know that, because Allah knows everything. But Allah didn't decide what we must choose. But because Allah knew what we are going to choose, Allah instructed the pen, record those things. That slave is going to do this tomorrow and that tomorrow, record it. That can't be changed. It's a record of the history of the entire universe and everything that's going to happen. That's untouchable. It's written in the preserved tablet. But as long as we don't understand this hadith to mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created or instructed the pen to record what Allah is going to do as far as our choices are concerned. The one thing we have that Allah has given us, and that's the only thing we have as human beings. Choice. Only jinn, and ons gaat hier nou baie praat van die jinn. Ons praat maar net van humankind, insan. Allah gave us the special quality to choose between right and wrong. Like somebody who is in Jannah, can they do wrong? Is it possible to do wrong in Jannah?
No.
It's been created, that environment of Jannah has been created such that you can only do good. But here on the dunya, Allah made it possible for us to also do good, but the possibility of bad, and Allah put choice in between. Now I'm going to judge you. But we spoke about this earlier, so I'm going to leave that there and go on to the attribute of power, inshallah. We must believe that Allah is all-powerful. As if a claim can fly, as if Allah is all-seeing, all-hearing, and all-powerful. And we all know that Allah is all-powerful. But what does it what does it actually mean? And how much further can we go than just say Allah is all-powerful? When we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful, we must realize that nothing in the entire creation, what we know of and what we don't know of, has any power. They don't have any power whatsoever. The power comes solely from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not even shaitan has power. We don't have power. The sun doesn't have power. But when we say that and we stop there, then it doesn't help us, because as human beings, we've got limitations how we can now take that further to understand. But what we must realize is that nothing can actually come into existence without the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That power is crucial to the existence of everything in the entire creation. In the absence of that power, there would have been no creation whatsoever. It brings things from a state of where it was not to where it is. From non-existence to existence, it requires power. Now the one thing that everything about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything, every single thing, when we talk about Allah, we must realize that we are talking about total and utter perfection. Which means that it has no limit, there's no boundaries, it cannot be added to and it cannot be subtracted. You can't add anything to perfection. Because perfection is perfection. There's no stage beyond perfection. So if we really want to say perfection doesn't exist, true perfection doesn't exist in creation. The only perfection that exists is when we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that's crucial to remember is that this power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, and you put petrol in, then you have no secondary power for the car to let drive. Or some things, but anyway, let's just know for no doubt was. So the car can drive. But as it uses that petrol up, so it reduces till it gets to a point where it is not. I said previously that we have this universe, what we call universe. Universe comes from the first part of the word universe. Uni means one. Scientists have now come to something that the Quran actually speaks about. They're talking about a concept of the multiverse. In other words, it doesn't mean the universe, but also to prate at one stage previously about the Big Bang and how this universe came into existence. Scientists have done very well to trace from close to the beginning of creation to where we are now, but they're talking about this universe. Allah speaks about the worlds in plural. And scientists are now coming up with the concept that there are more than one universe. Whether they will ever get to that point where they will discover is another story. But what I'm trying to say is that every single thing in this entire universe of ours and all the other worlds and the ghaib, the unseen worlds, is directly under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's control. And Allah manages that without any difference to Allah's complete and utter power. It doesn't change it, not a fraction of it. Now, what are we really talking about? We don't really understand what that means to control this universe. So I think I've done this before, but I'm going to touch it on again, is to give you an idea of one of the symbols that we see as a source of power. Without the sun, there would be no earth. Not only because we orbit around the sun, but the source of energy for everything, for every human being, every form of life on this planet depends on the sun. Sun converts, the sunlight is converted by plants into chemical energy. The chemical energy is eaten by the cows and whatever else we eat, and that gets put into the body, and the body transfers it back to chemical energy and electrical energy, and we are able to operate because of the sun. So if we look at the sun, what do we know about the sun? Apart from it, vandag het ons het baie gesien because it was cloudy. But if we understand a bit about the sun, it gives us an inkling of how powerful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really is. The sun is a star, a cold star, and its temperature right at the center, at the core of the star, is about 15 million degrees. 15 million degrees. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. 15 million degrees Celsius at the core. But other stars, and that's why the reason why I refer to it as a cold star, there are other stars in the universe that are billions of degrees compared to our sun, which is only 15 million. Remember, I'm saying not. I'm comparing million with billion there. So that's why it's referred to as a cold star. The sun is not made up of solid matter. It's made up of gas, mainly helium and hydrogen gas. Such an amazing entity out there in the universe. It's not a solid object. It's made up mainly of gas. And it exists now for 5 billion years, and scientists say it's only halfway through its lifespan. It will probably last another 5 billion years. Billion, it's prati million, prat billion. Look at what kind of power, now we're making a direct link to the power of one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. 600 million ton of gas is consumed by the sun for every single second of its existence. Every single second, a ton, what is a ton? 1,000 kilograms. 1,000 kilograms.
2,000 pounds.
Kilograms.
And then you're going to get frictions.
A thousand kilograms. 600 million times 1,000 kilograms every single second of his entire existence. And how long did I say it's been existence?
5 billion years.
5 billion years. How many seconds in a year? 31.5 million seconds in a year. In 1 year. As jy lang koppen nog nie draai nie, dan het jy een superhens. It's almost impossible to fathom how much energy, potential energy is in the sun. Because if you convert all these figures, then you run out of zeros. You run out of zeros. En ons mind, in fact, as jy kom hier by 1 million as petrols, om al klaar te kom. Nou praat jy, next to die is billion, en achter die is trillion, dan het kom hulle by kwant, trillion, en wat hele ander, pentrillion, en dan gaan aan, hulle het al uitgehakeloop, uit terminology. Nou wat hulle nou maak, they say everything to the power 10. Then they just multiply it by so many zeros. Because hulle kan nie a word het vir amal die nie meer van die soul nie, but if you go into understanding the universe. So 600 million ton of gas every single second. Allahu Akbar!
Allahu Akbar!
Wow! And this is a cold star.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah.
And I said it's only halfway through its existence.
Allah.
So whatever has happened over the last 5 billion years and another 5 billion years to come, Allah. If Allah allows it to continue until then.
Allah.
And just a throwaway point that I thought I would add in here, because it's 150 million kilometers, the sun is 150 million kilometers away from the earth, it actually takes 8 minutes for that, if you were to switch on a switch by the sun and switch it on, it will take 8 minutes to travel that 150 kilometers before it reaches the earth.
Oh, radiation. Light.
Light.
Heat.
Not just the heat, the light itself, for us to see it and to experience it. It takes 8 minutes. So technically, Marcos, Maghrib, 8 minutes late. If you want to go according to this. But Allah didn't make it so difficult for us. But if you look at how powerful the sun is, and I'm going to show you another clip that I used before. Those of you who are here will know that this is a clip of the Milky Way. And we are part of the cluster called the Milky Way. And we are some. We are somewhere there. You have any daughters?
Yes, I
know. There's his son. His son with his 9 planets is somewhere here.
Yes, I know.
Can you see the red the thing?
Yes.
In fact, since my hand moved a half of a paar million kilometers away. But if you think that the sun is a cold star and some of these things are even more intense in heat, then what kind of power does that represent? Just the Milky Way alone.
Allah.
And there's billions of them. Allah created it, all of it.
Allah.
And that wasn't even a drop in the ocean. It didn't take away anything from Allah's greatness and power. So if you say Allah is powerful, then think of Allah as being powerful like this. Also, mind that Allah afgeswitcht, Allah is more powerful than even our minds can comprehend. Yep. And no matter if we were able to measure, we wouldn't find a way of measuring even the amount and the intensity of what we have there. Wil nie te carry the way raak nie, want iemand gaat my sê, ek het ons al goeie tyd in. Another few points that might seem a bit technical and scientific, but it's good for us to know about this. Scientists have proven, we're not talking about the theory now, we're talking about proof, and they can prove it. That No new energy can be created, nor can it be destroyed. It's what they refer to as a closed loop. It changes from one form to another, but the energy that this universe is made up remains the same. Where did this energy come from? Comes from Allah. Yeah, but from what was the forum on the planet? Allah subhanahu. No, not even from the sun. The sun also gets its energy from a process even before that. From the Big Bang. And the Big Bang was Allahu Akbar. The sun. Top of the class. From the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know that everything in the entire creation was just taken a portion of the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, think of that when you make salawat. How intense is that nur? That is that Allah shows us all the energy, where it comes from, at the material level, that we can understand. And that was just a spark. And not even a spark as the khurud to say, it is just the flash of the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which itself, the nur of Allah, has absolutely no limits whatsoever. So if we say Allah is powerful, understand now when you say Allah is powerful, understand it like that. You say Allah is powerful. What means that Allah is powerful? Allah is powerful! Allahu Akbar!
Allah.
Now Einstein and the intelligence to understand some of these things. Einstein came up with a theory, and I'm going to go into all of this because then it's going to become very technical. He shows us how energy power can be converted into mass. And that's his formula, E equals mc squared. And Haradar was phenomenal. But I want to remind you where that first spark of nur came from. The nur from which every single thing in this entire universe of ours came from, the nur of Rasulullah And they calculated, scientists went back and they got very, very advanced formulas of how they've calculated that. As was eendag regtig interested is, and then we can explain the claims that ek opgetel het om te understand how they actually came to this. That they said that that first intense spark of heat from which everything else was created was 10 to the power of 40. 10, and it makes you degrees Celsius.
Yes,
that's 10 to the power of 40
trillion,
degrees Celsius.
Trillion.
Ek het nog makkelijk het maak om mense om te verstaan, elke 6 minute space in between is a million, en so gaat het aan. That is how intense the first part is.
Yes, sir.
Ek wil nou amper een ander punt gemaakt, maar dan gaat het vir my nou uitgooi nou van die vlug. Now we know the power comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a group called the Qadariya. Now the Qadariya should not be confused with the Qadariya, the people who follow in the path of Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jailani, Qadir Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Aziz. These are people who had a certain type of belief. Spraat nou van, hoe ons moet groeien Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said that once Allah puts power, gives us power or energy, just for Bora, no crazy energy, whoever your energy create, Allah grants you that power. They believe that once Allah has granted you that power, then Allah leaves you on your own. So you know your power, and no country your power for breaks and zero. And you must account for it. They do believe all the power comes from Allah, but Allah takes, they believe, from His own power, His divine power, grants it to human beings, and then once they have that power, no matter the choices mark, and no matter the leave, but Allah can do what you want. Now let me tell you, I believed like that for a long time. It is common om to say, but I'm mentioning this to you so that if you believe like this, this is the time for you to correct it. We need that Allah had for gegee, leave nie, and there is a chance on your leave nie, but you need the right choices maak nie. I'll explain why we are saying this. I believed like that for a long time, tot op my oude dae het gehoor, iemand sê, Pierre, ek is 70, ek het nie meer wegstiekie. So, I think it's only in the past, probably 10 or 15 years, that I started going back to these issues, and especially the time when I was linked to my worship. Sheikh Qazi Mahmoud Ghazala, ek en Uma was voor iets van die master, Sufi, living soul, that I corrected my understanding. It's important for us to understand this point. They believe that once they have been given the choice, they can do as they please. But they must take the consequences. Bad, gaan ze gestraft worden. Good, going to get reward. Jannah, Jahannam. Sounds very, very logical and plausible. And for years, people have believed like that. And there was a time in the history of Islam where there was a lot of confusion about the aqidah of how we should actually believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now why, in fact some people, some of the ulama, believe this group that believes like that, ek het gebeur wat ek daar hoor, ja Allah, ek het die ketting in geval, are actually disbelievers. If you believe Allah has given you power, and it belongs to you now, as long as you do what you can, and the reason why it's wrong, is that you believe that you have power and Allah has power. You are actually saying there are two sources of power. Allah has transferred power to you, so they can do what they will, and as Allah will each do, knows that was conflict is. Because as Allah sees, they can do what they will. So long as they have verantwoord and they grow net so. It's very, very, very dangerous. Correct that in your own understanding. That whatever power Allah has given you or anyone else or anything else in this dunya belongs to Allah ultimately. It has been given to you for a particular period and it's under Allah's direct control. You never have control over that power. Like the sun can be switched off because that power comes from Allah. That is why creating effect is to make things happen. You do something that has a certain result or a certain outcome or a certain consequences. That's the if your whatever you do or decide has a certain consequence or an effect. It's important to know that Allah is the only one who can create effect. Nothing else can create effect. Let me illustrate it quickly now. Everything that happens waits on the permission of Allah. The the permission for it to happen. It doesn't have its own power. It doesn't have its own independent will that stands on its own. It waits for the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it can act or do anything. So if it's not willed by Allah, it will not happen. And if nothing moves, or if movement and even stillness is under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's direct control. If we use the example of water, if you drink water, water quenches your thirst, generally speaking. Now, if you put your hand in the fire, it will burn. If you take a knife and you stab someone, you will bleed. Are we saying that the water has the ability to quench the thirst? Or that the knife has the ability to cut? Yeah, I'm going to say, yeah. At the basic level, at the material level, yes. But if we talk about the correct belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will understand, al drink the yellow burger of oh. It doesn't necessarily mean or guarantee that my thirst will be quenched. So the ability for the thirst to be quenched, the consequence or the result of how the means, the water, is used by Allah generally to quench the thirst, yes. But it doesn't reside, it doesn't live in the water. It's not the inherent, inbuilt component of the water. That ability to quench the thirst comes from Allah.
Subhanallah.
The effect of the quenching of the thirst doesn't reside and live in the water. The fire can't burn on its own because it doesn't have that. It doesn't have the ability to create effect or consequence. That ability only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Subhanallah.
The example of Nabi Ibrahim when he put his when he was thrown in the fire is a good example. When he wanted to use a knife to cut, the knife can't cut unless Allah wills for it to cut. If it was like some people believe, that was not true. Allah puts that power in that thing, and Allah will let it happen, and Allah stands aside. It means that, say, if we use the example of the knife, what would have happened? Allah transferred the power, independent power, to the knife to be able to do certain things. If Nabi Ibrahim cut his son's throat, it would have been able to do that. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cooled the fire and made the knife not to cut is clear proof for us. In case we get confused, Allah puts these things in the Quran to demonstrate for us. That's an example for you. What khulu?
Allah
Akbar. Ik maak het makkelijk voor jullie.
Allah Akbar.
Jullie moeten allemaal zo slim zoals iemand mee.
Astagfirullah. Zeg wat daar tip in de rifaan.
Ja. Dat is een example.
Dat is eigenlijk een zin. Dat is eigenlijk snijden. Niks voor jullie. Dat is dat.
Ja. Maar dan komen mensen met andere stukken stories als jullie. Nee, ratiep, een strikkerie en een stomzaal en andere dingen. But Allah, remember, when Allah speaks through the Quran. The one contact we have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Rabb, our creator, of all of that other stuff that we showed here, speaks to each one of us directly through the Quran.
Subhanallah.
Directly to each one of us. The words of Allah, and it has remained unchanged. Don't say the Quran is the word of Allah. That's another discussion. Because yes, it's something that has a material form, and Allah, anything about Allah cannot be compared to anything that is material or worldly. But the content and the message, that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ah, I'm so excited, man. So the water and the knife and everything can only do what they, what we understand him to do, if Allah wills for it to do it.
Allah is
Allah.
And it's also believed that once power is deposited in anything, that you can do with that power whatever you want. Even that power when it transfers, somebody once used an example. So I said, can you see Eskom? Once you connected us to the grid, and now it's your switch, your things on, and there got your electric box on, now can you do what you will every house. Die bankie so. That at one stage it sounded like a nice explanation. That everything comes from Allah as the main power station, so to speak. But you don't have the right to do with that power what you want, even if it is in your house. Oh. Our situation is different. Allah is in control of every effect. No one it's Allah is in control of every single thing to create effect. Because if anything else could create effect, which we explain, it means actions. Now that power is there, actions can emanate or result from different people as well as from Allah, and you will have conflict, which is totally impossible. Allah is control of every effect. Effect can only be created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Use the example of
Allah,
that bird.
Subhanallah.
Every flap of the wing of the bird is made up of individual little bits and pieces. It doesn't mean that Allah says to the bird, fly, no kalima, flap off. The other example, the water that drips from the tap, that Allah allows the water to drip of DNA and bitter and on the waste. That Allah says, okay, I give you permission to fly. Now can I fly till Allah afswitch? The ability of the fly? It's verkeerde way to go. I have gesukkel with it. And iemand has me convinced that it is so. And the more I examined this, I understood if this bird can fly, then it means I am giving power to the bird. Every single bit of movement of the flap of that wing and anything else that the bird does is never independent or separate and under the direct micromanagement and control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like every coral tree, sun, doesn't move. Whether there's wind or not wind, it doesn't move unless Allah wills for that grain of sand to move. And everything else, and including everything that we do in our lives. I'm going to end up there, rather. Okay, let me get the last point, man. So now we say, let me give up switch, because that's what you're about. We mustn't make the mistake now. So effect to make things happen can only come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We maybe have a better understanding now of that. Nothing has the ability to create effect. Kan jy nou voor die bus gaan staan en sê, jy kan nie vir my stap nie, jy het niks, jy kan nie effect create nie. Net Allah kan nie. Allah kan net dinge wat gebeur. Kan jy dit doen?
Nee.
Kan jy dit? Jy kan dit doen, maar hy bus gaan vir jou aanslaan.
Wat is dat?
The thing about this is, we never know what Allah has willed. That's this, the last part of this presentation which we must come to. Don't go and stand in front of the bus and say, you can't love me, because effect only comes from Allah. If Allah wants to give effect to the bus to do that or not, it's entirely up to Allah. And we only find out afterwards. So don't go stand in front of the bus or take a knife. I think Basari can understand what I mean by. But ek sal nie vir julle sê om dit te doen nie. Vat die saal, sny of sny jou tong af of whatever. You can't do that. Generally speaking, you must abide by the laws of nature and wait and give due recognition that power only comes from Allah and only Allah can make it happen. But when you get to the point where you get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what happens? When you want, like the awliya can for the bus stand, I can the bus not stop. And we've seen and heard about things like this. So as you grow closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah will give you the ability to almost depend that Allah will make things happen because of your closeness and your proximity. So finding a way to get closer to Allah is very important. I want to leave it like that for now, inshallah. And under normal circumstances, at the other place where I also do a similar kind of input. Het die mense baie vra. Vanaand gaat ons nie daai doen nie. I'm going to switch over to the second part of what Imam said. Ek gaat my community activist kerk na aantrek. Het sal my oefeer daar sit. We're going to talk about the problem that exists here in South Africa, the drug problem. We don't have to have people